This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It is so good to gather together to worship with you at First Ozark today, for those in person and those joining us online and also on the radio. A few announcements as we get started. As you can see, we're back in person. And that means that all of our committee meetings, our grief groups, and other in-person events are back on. Speaking of that, this evening our worship in the chapel will be at 6 p.m. On Wednesday, we'll have our noon Bible study at 12 noon in the fellowship hall, and this week the text will be coming from 2 John. On September 30th, the church will be going to an Atlanta Braves game. We'll be leaving the church at around 10:30 in the morning. If you're interested in going to that, you are invited to speak to Les or also to call the church office by September the 9th. And then also this afternoon from 1 to 2, we will be having a shower, a drive-through shower for Kimber Willis, and you are invited to join there as well. As we hear this prelude, let us prepare our hearts for worship. Let us join together in our responsive reading. You who live in the shelter of the Most High will say, "My God, in whom I trust."
No evil shall befall those who make the Lord their refuge, the Most High their dwelling place.
God will deliver those who love the Lord and call on God's name.
When they call,
let us worship God. Let us join together in our congregational prayer. Your goodness goes before us, O Holy Redeemer, and the upright rejoice in your radiant splendor. Your touch turns deserts into pools of living water. As you embrace the land, its yield abounds. With wisdom, you implant. We shall proclaim your virtue. Through our Savior, Christ Jesus, we shall sing your praise without ceasing. You're invited to stand for our hymn of praise, "This Is My Father's World," number 144. Let us join together in affirming our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us ask God's blessing on this offering. Gracious God, we know that all good things come from you. May this offering be a blessing to the people of the world, both in this community and around the globe. We thank you for the opportunity to give to you with joyful hearts today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. invited to remain standing for our hymn of preparation, Rescue the Perishing, number 591. Let us listen as we go to God in prayer. You may be seated. Gracious and generous God, you bestow upon us the gift of your love. Forgive us, we pray, when we don't see or recognize your gifts for what they are, when we take what you give and beg for more, when we hoard our gifts and do not hear the mournful cry of those around us. We pray for all in need today, in Afghanistan, in Haiti, in Louisiana, and all around the world. Teach us the ways of godliness and grant us a spirit of contentment that we may be grateful for your provision and share the gifts you give with others, blessing the world. As we are blessed by you, so may we be a blessing to the others. In the name of your matchless gift, our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us how to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. That was beautiful, David. Thank you. Our scripture reading for today comes from Luke chapter 16, verses 19 to 31. It says, "There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames.' But Abraham said, 'Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us.' He said, 'Then, my father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment.' Abraham replied, 'They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them.' He said, 'No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent.' He said to him, 'If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead.' This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God."
Thank you, Melanie. Melanie and I have been preaching a series based on discipleship. Phil Maynard and Eddie Pipkin, They share from their book, Disciple Like Jesus. You might be surprised that even people who've been in church for a long time fail to make the connection between service and discipleship. A colleague of Phil's, who also helps with church development, was preaching in a local church one Sunday about discipleship. And afterwards, a gentleman came up to him and said, "Who changed the rules?" And his friend said, "What rules are you talking about?" And the fellow went on to say that he had been going to that church for 50 years. And in that time, he had never heard anyone ever talk about how that, as a disciple, that he was called to serve. Now think about that. Could someone actually come to church for 50 years? Could he have slept through all of those parts of the sermon? Or are Christian leaders failing to make Jesus' expectations crystal clear? I'm seeking to make our Lord's expectations clear. That to be a disciple is to serve enthusiastically, regularly, to put others first. Discipleship and service, they are inseparable. We are following Jesus, who came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Matthew 20, 28. So how can we live in days like these with the pandemic? So many people are concerned. Let us pray for relief. Pray for a new beginning. Let us also not just focus on ourselves. So many are worried and distressed for themselves, their families. Let us grow as disciples and seek to bless the world, to bless our community in the name of Jesus Christ. So I think we can learn from the rich man what not to do. The parable of the rich man and Lazarus. The curtain is pulled back on the rich man. And we see his fate, that he worshiped money instead of God. In the first part of the parable, the theme is judgment and trading places. The second part of the parable is the affirmation of the law and the prophets. What the rich man praised in this life was an abomination to God. The unnamed rich man who wore my favorite color, purple, he feasted sumptuously every day. Now, how might you picture the rich man's life? Like one of those the lifestyles of the rich and famous, who had a great big mansion and a yacht, butlers and maids, living the good life, the American dream. Why could this be an abomination to God? Why does the Gospel of Luke not like rich people? Luke 18, 25. It is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Or Luke 6, 20, blessed are those who are poor. Could that be right? Why are the poor blessed? One thing is, the poor know that they are in need, that they are not self-sufficient. It becomes blatantly clear. The rich man thought that he was sufficient, living in luxury. So is it a sin to be rich? No, of course not. But I see that the rich man, his life was way out of balance. I think about Matthew 6, 33. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. William Barclay points out the sin of the rich man was not what he did, but that he did nothing to help Lazarus, who was his neighbor. We are called to be disciples, disciples who bless this world, who care deeply, who have eyes that are open and hearts that are open to help those all around us. Phil Maynard points out in his book, Membership to Discipleship. We are called to serve in action, to feed the hungry, to visit the sick, to care for the grieving, to welcome the stranger, to love in action, to join God where God is already at work, making disciples. At the end of Matthew's gospel, Jesus sends out his followers to make disciples. But Maynard points out, we cannot make disciples. That is God's work to make disciples. We merely provide the framework, the educational opportunities to help people grow as disciples. 1 Corinthians 3:7, some water and some plant, but God causes the growth. To God be the glory. Do you consider yourself a rich person? We are rich compared to so many who live in this world. What with our closets overflowing with clothes, plenty of food at home waiting for us, nice clothes, transportation, we have so much to be thankful for. And the more God blesses our lives, the more of a reason we have to be humble. What profit a person to gain the whole world and yet to lose or forfeit their very soul? Luke 9:25. So, what about you or me? If we were in this parable as the rich man, how would we have lived differently? How would we bless those who are in need all around us? How would we have had compassion and mercy upon Lazarus? We are called to live differently as disciples of Jesus Christ and bless this world in practical and tangible ways. Ron Sider writes in his book, Rich Christians in an Age of Hunger, that God identifies with those who are poor and hungry. Each year, over 35,000 children die of malnutrition and diseases related to malnutrition. How shall Christians respond? Will we insist that the God revealed in Scripture seeks to liberate those who are captive? Luke 4:18. Will we stand with the overfed or with the starving? Will we stand with the rich man or with Lazarus? This is a difficult parable, but it causes us to reflect, how are we about blessing this world? When the luxuries of this life can blind us to those who are in need, we can see the rich man as a symbol of the United States, the land of the brave and the free. We are so fortunate. We have so much to be thankful for. So oftentimes, we can take the blessings of God for granted. And we can become complacent. This terrible coronavirus has shaken us to our knees. Recognize how we need to pray. Pray for those who are sick. And remind us, we all need healing, but we also need spiritual healing. Those who are poor and those who are rich, we all need Jesus. Lazarus, he reminds me of someone who lives in a third world country like Brazil. I've gone to Brazil before on a mission trip, and there's such hunger for the gospel there. When you meet someone in Brazil, oftentimes one of the first things you find is a person asks, are you a believer? Such an openness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. People need the Lord. And too often those who are wealthy forget how God has blessed us beyond measure. Let us seek to remember the lessons that we can learn from the rich man. One of the valuable lessons is to much is given. Much is required. Let us seek to be a blessing, to care for those in need and serve. Well, as Paul Harvey would say, now the rest of the story, you find Lazarus, who was poor. Now you think about Lazarus. He would have loved to trade places with the rich man in this life. He was hungry, always desperate for food, and he had sores, and the dogs would come and lick his sores. He was in agony. There at the rich man's gate, how do you see Lazarus? My grandmother was never hungry, but she struggled with rheumatoid arthritis and cancer. She was in pain constantly. And one night, she took an overdose of sleeping pills and committed suicide. And I'll never forget the words etched on her tombstone. Earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Do we believe that? Did Lazarus live with that kind of courageous hope? Did he trust and believe that in spite of how difficult it is right now, that his relationship with God gave him strength and hope and courage and the determination to make it through a very difficult time? He was desperate. Feed me. Help me. And the rich man had no time for him. We see the rich man, he goes to torment, to Hades. What was the rich man's sin? It wasn't that he was wealthy, but his God became his money and his possessions. He was poor towards God. Like in Luke chapter 12, when Jesus shares the parable about the rich man who built bigger and bigger barns. And Jesus says, "You fool, for tonight your soul will be required from you." Think about this rich man who longed for relief. He was in agony there in hell. What is our understanding of hell? Think about John Calvin writes that we bring judgment upon ourselves. The story of the rich man and Lazarus calls upon us to repent while there is time, to repent and to trust in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. He is our hope and salvation. The rich man, he was in agony and he cries out. He begs Father Abraham to help him. Now, have you ever been just so exhausted, so tired, dehydrated? He longs for Lazarus just to cool the tip of his tongue. And Abraham patiently explains to him that there is a great chasm between us, and it's not going to be. He wants Lazarus, who he did not help in this life, to help him. But there still is a group that perhaps there is hope for. That's his five brothers. He wants relief for them. Maybe the rich man thinks, well, they're just as self-absorbed as he was. Father Abraham tells him that they have Moses and the prophets. They have enough to see clearly the importance to trust in God and to serve others. Oh, no, but if someone would come from the dead, foreshadowing of Jesus, the Holy One who died and is risen. If he would go, if Lazarus would go, if he would go from the dead to wake them up, the parable of Lazarus and the rich man, it calls upon us to think about our destiny, to think about things in more of an eternal perspective. We are only passing through this world. What do we want to be known for? What will others say about us? What will our epitaph be? Now, I hope that Melanie is learning from me as the associate. When I was the associate pastor, when I was in seminary in Brandenburg, Kentucky, I learned so much from the senior pastor. He said that a pastoral care didn't count unless it was 1 hour. That's right. And he would bring his preaching magazine with him, and he would put it down on the pulpit and read from it. Yes, I learned so much what not to do. Hope that won't be her excuse. We won't put her on the spot right now. Oh, but we can learn so much from the rich man what not to do. We still have time to repent, to trust in Jesus Christ, and to faithfully serve and to bless our world. We have time now. We have so much to look forward to as Christians. When we all get to heaven, the joy we will have as people who are growing disciples, seeking to bless this world in the name of Christ. That is my challenge, my encouragement to you, to grow as a disciple and seek to bless the community all around you in practical and tangible ways. Let us live out our faith in the coming week. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You're welcome to respond in faith and commitment as we stand together and sing our hymn invitation, When We All Get to Heaven, hymn number 701.